piece, you should have two things for me, right? You should have the writing on Antigone, and you should also have the writing that you started last week, right? With the two journal articles. So pass up your ink clustering on Antigone. Yes?
Was this supposed to be about a quote? You said an improv writing.
Yeah, yeah. Yep, same way we always do. So yeah, pass up the Antigone papers first, and then when I've collected those, pass up the writing you did on those articles. I do also want the articles that you worked from. If you don't have physical copies of those, you can email those to me later. Just don't forget to do it. This Antigone file. Thank you. Thank you. And if you could now just pass up the other thing. It's okay. You guys don't need to staple these. I can keep them sorted. Oh, you put your phone. Yeah, it's okay. I'll find it.
Thank you.
Okay. So as we are coming up on the end of the term, we only have six more class meetings after this one. I think we ought to talk a little bit about the final paper and what's going to be expected for that. So the final paper is essentially going to be a bigger version of what you've already been doing, right? It's going to be longer, it's going to involve research. That is one of the reasons why I wanted you to do that little project last week with the two articles, right? I wanted you to take and try to synthesize other sources' ideas. So, what you're going to do here for paper three, right? This is going to be this is going to be 4,000 words long, so it's going to be considerably longer than the other two. But remember, you're going to be using secondary sources for this, right? And if you're quoting from secondary sources, that'll make up much of the difference. You will choose one play that we've discussed in class, and construct an argument about how that play presents a particular theme or idea. You will need to use at least five outside sources, only one of which can be an online-only source. Now, by online-only source, I mean things that you get from the internet, not through our library, right? You can use any number of things that you get from our library. In fact, I would recommend, by and large, that you stick to approved library sources. If you use anything else, then just try to remember the material from that day we went over how to review a website for quality, right? Now, the sources you use can be literary criticism of the work that you are looking at, they can be works of general literary criticism, or they can be drawn from other disciplines, right? Anything that you think is applicable to the text that you're working out, that you're working on, and is an adequate scholarly source, right? So, you know, if you want to look at something like the way a particular play deals with space, right? Or, you know, imagine domestic space, things like that. Maybe architectural theory works for that. There might be a play for which, you know, say business theory or management theory seems to be applicable, right? One of the cool things about English studies is that you can apply just about anything else to a work of literature, right? There are people who use anthropology, who use neurology, who use all sorts of other fields to talk about literature. So if it's applicable to your argument and it's a valid scholarly source, go ahead and use it. Formatting rules are pretty much the same. Now, as far as what sorts of sources you can use, you can use scholarly books and journals in any discipline. And remember, again, that difference between a scholarly source and a popular source, right? A scholarly source is aimed specifically at an academic audience. A popular source is aimed at everybody, right? I want you to try to stick to scholarly sources. You can use journal articles you find online through JSTOR, the MLA bibliography, right? All of which, as we know, is available through the Carter Library's website.
Through Galileo.
Yeah, just, but again, like, go through the specific databases in Galileo because it'll make your life easier in the long run. And I want to reiterate too, again, like, if you need any help with your research, right, come talk to me. I'm happy to help you. And it's also a good idea to make an appointment with John Wilson in the library. He can actually probably give you better, more specific help than I can. It's his job to run this stuff. Things that are not appropriate sources, right? For reasons we've already discussed. Wikipedia or any other encyclopedia, right? This is not a high school report anymore. Do not use book reviews. They only tell you whether you should or should not read a book. Do not use newspaper or magazine articles, right? Aimed at too broad an audience. Do not use random shit that you find on the Google. Do not use Cliff Notes, Spark Notes, Schmoop.com, Masterplots, or other similar summary sites. Right? Not so much because I have an objection to the existence of these sites, you know, in their totality, although Schmoop.com kind of pisses me off a little bit because of its tone. What the hell does Schmoop mean anyway? It makes me angry. But the reason I don't want you using these sites is because, by and large, all they do is provide a summary, right? These are the places you go if you don't understand what's happening on the level of plot in a text. They're not going to give you very much real deep analysis. So that's why I don't want you using these. One more thing. I didn't put it on the sheet, but because this comes up sometimes, I know that there are probably people in this room who have very, very strong religious convictions, but the Bible is also usually not appropriate as a secondary source for a research project. Right? What I'm looking for is analysis of the particular text, not how it relates to your personal belief system. All right, so when you are working with secondary sources, right? I know that journal articles probably seem like the easier way to go because they're going to be shorter, right? The average academic journal article is usually about 20 pages. But don't leave books completely out of the equation. By and large, if you're doing research on a specific topic, you're not going to need to read that entire book. Read the introduction to get the gist of the author's argument, and then, you know, use the index to find a relevant, you know, chapters that are relevant to what you're actually studying. And just read those parts of the book that are relevant. You don't actually have to sit there and read the whole 300-page scholarly tome. Yes?
As an example, for my research paper in one of my couple of history classes, I have like a 800-page, just basically detailed account of like splitting up different rules of kings. Literally all I needed was 20 pages of like three kings rules.
Yeah. So you find the part of the book that you actually need and you focus on that. When you are dealing with sources that offer counter arguments to your thesis, right, that seem to contradict your thesis, don't just throw them away. Don't just ignore them. And don't think that you also necessarily have to change your thesis. What you want to do when you run up against arguments that don't jive with your thesis is try to think about to what extent you agree with this approach and where it diverges from you, right? How far can you go along in agreeing with it, and what do you think it gets wrong? Don't be afraid to be critical of what other people have written, right? that's sort of the basis of scholarship, right? It's a long conversation between lots of people working on the same stuff. Yeah, it's okay, even if you don't have a PhD, to be critical of people who do have them. If you find sources with whom you agree absolutely, who seem to have already come up with your argument before you, then what you need to do there is find a place where you don't agree, right? Find something in that source that you think they're ignoring or something that you think they're getting wrong. Always explain why your sources mean what you think they mean, right? It's the same thing I tell you to do when you're quoting from your primary source text in a paper, right? Always explain where you got your interpretation from. And remember, above all, that the paper is not just a conduit for a bunch of secondary sources, right? What you need to do is find your own voice in this conversation and find your own arguments. Now, you'll be doing this by playing sources off of each other, right? By putting them into conversation with each other, imagining how they would respond to each other, and then finding a place for yourself in that, right? Is there something that you think all of your sources have missed? Is there something that you think putting a couple of your sources together explains better than either does than any of them do individually? That sort of thing. And make sure that your own argument is what's paramount here, right? That's what's key. Does anybody have any questions about this? Yeah, Gabrielle. This is all the assignment sheet is on the Georgia View site in the syllabus and assignments folder. Pardon?
I was just asking if that
page. Oh yeah, yeah. All of the assignments are posted online. Any other questions? Okay, so the first draft of this is going to be due May 1st, right? And you're going to bring the draft, as usual, to the exam, to the what would have been the exam session, right? Except this is a composition class, so exams are pointless. And we're going to do peer review. And then the paper itself will be due on Friday the 5th. Pardon?
Turn it online, just like regular.
Yeah, turn it online just as always. Yep. So you'll submit the draft Monday at Monday, May 1st at midnight. I'll go over the drafts, and then you'll get me the final paper by that Friday. Any other questions? Okay. So then, check that. I'm sorry, was that a question or? Pardon?
Is the final day in the class May 1st or the 3rd?
It was supposed to be May 1st, unless they changed it. Which sometimes they do. Pardon?
I think May 2nd is the last day of all classes.
But no, we're not in. All right, let me just double check this. Calendar. Exam schedule. All right, we are Monday, Wednesday, 9:30. Yeah, our exam period is Monday, May 1st, 10:30 to 12:30. That is when we are supposed to be here.
So what time?
10:30 to 12:30. Yep. Which I believe that that is on the syllabus. But okay, it's good that we double checked and we know. All right, so back to drama. How many of you have any experience with Shakespeare? How many of you have read Shakespeare before? Okay, that's almost all of you. How many of you have read actual Shakespeare and not like the No Fear Shakespeare that modernizes the language? Okay, that's still a fairly good number of you, right? No offense to those of you who have read No Fear Shakespeare, but that's not really Shakespeare. What plays have you read? What plays are you familiar with?
Macbeth.
Okay.
Antigone.
Okay, you've read this one before. What did you say?
Antigone.
Okay, Antigone is that's Sophocles, that's a Greek play, yeah.
Romeo and Juliet.
Okay. All right, so those of you who have read Hamlet before, what do you already know about it?
It's a tragedy.
Okay, yeah, it is. Falls loosely into the broad category of plays that we call tragedy. Now, we should know, right, if we watched the video that we were supposed to watch instead of coming to class on Wednesday, that the Greeks had a very specific definition of tragedy, right, that does not quite correspond to the modern meaning of the word. And in Shakespeare's time, the definition of tragedy they're dealing with is a little bit broader, but is also still rather more specific than we would use. So Hamlet itself falls into a subcategory called revenge tragedy, which is also sometimes called Senecan tragedy, because the inventor of this particular form was the Roman philosopher Seneca. It's also sometimes called the tragedy of blood. Because it is very, very violent. Now, Antigone contains acts of violence as well, right? But where does all of the violence happen in Antigone? Do we actually see any of it? Yeah, all of the violence in a Greek play typically takes place off stage. You almost never see anyone fighting or anyone getting killed. Greek plays are very, very talky, right? It's essentially people coming out and giving speeches and sometimes responding to other people's speeches. But yeah, a tragedy of blood includes a great deal of onstage violence, particularly by the time you get to the end of the play. Now, Hamlet is probably a little bit less bloody than a lot of these other plays were, but the body count by the end of the play is still pretty high. Now, these plays were amazingly popular in the late 15th and early 16th centuries. And they all follow a fairly similar pattern in terms of plot, right? You have an Avenger character and he or his relatives have been wronged in some way, right? And you can almost always identify the Avenger character physically, because he's the one who's dressed entirely in black. Just as we're told in Act 1, Scene 2, right, that Hamlet has been wearing nothing but black since his father's death, right? Now, Shakespeare makes the occasion for Hamlet's wearing black mourning for his father's death, but according to Elizabethan stage conventions, that also identifies him as the Avenger character. Though he's different from a typical Avenger in some ways that we'll get to in a moment. Now, what the Avenger then proceeds to do is systematically and often cleverly eliminate all those who have wronged him. Usually in spectacularly violent ways. Sometimes, as in Christopher Marlowe's play, The Jew of Malta, the Avenger is caught and punished himself at the end. He almost always dies. Even when his vengeance is accomplished successfully. So...
So no Montresor?
No, yeah. No Montresors. These Avengers flame out. Always. Almost always. I'm trying to think of an example of a play in which the Avenger survives, and I can't. Because typically, he's got nothing left to live for anyway. All of his ties have already been cut before the play began. So, another thing that these plays tend to feature is a lot of sexual innuendo and descriptions of various kinds of sexual perversity, right? These plays are sensationalistic in just about every sense of the word, right? Not only are they sensationally violent, they also tended to try to tweak the audience's libidinal interests as well, right? So if we can't lure you in with the violence, we'll lure you in with the sex.
Old action movie?
Yeah. It's, you know, I would say that these are usually a little bit smarter than the typical contemporary action movie is, but that wouldn't be hard. So... Where do we see this sort of thing already in Hamlet? This sort of unnatural or weird sexual relationships.
The uncle and the mother?
Yeah. We get the sense of this marriage between Claudius the king and Gertrude the queen, wife of the previous king, Claudius's brother, right? This is described as incestuous. Now, again, by modern standards, it wouldn't be considered incestuous because they're not blood relatives, right? But there's something weird and unnatural about marrying your dead brother's wife immediately after he has passed on. And we see another of Hamlet's characters. One of the things that makes him odd for an Avenger when he's describing the wedding and what motivated it to Horatio, right? If we look in Act 1, Scene 2, around line 176, right? Horatio says, "My lord, I came to see your father's funeral." Hamlet responds, "I prithee do not mock me, fellow students. I think it was to see my mother's wedding. Indeed, my lord, it followed hard upon. Thrift, thrift, Horatio. The funeral baked meats did coldly furnish forth the marriage tables." Right, so the joke that Hamlet is making here, right, is that they married immediately after the funeral so that they could save money on the wedding feast, right? We still had the funeral buffet, right? Just eat the leftovers. Now, one of the roles that Hamlet plays is that of the fool. And not the fool as in, like, you know, the idiot, the moron, right? The fool, or the jester, actually played a very, very important role in medieval courts. Does anybody know what the fool was allowed to do that no one else was?
He was the only one who was allowed to tell the truth to the king.
Yeah, the fool was the only one who was allowed to tell the absolute unvarnished truth to the king all the time and not be punished for it. There's still vestiges of this. For example, in the British Parliament, there's a member of Parliament whose job it is to yell insults at the Queen whenever she comes to address Parliament. It's supposed to keep her humble. But that harkens back to the old tradition of the fool who can tell the truth to the king. And what Hamlet is, whenever Hamlet is in conversation with someone he doesn't respect, right, whether it's the king or Polonius or his mother, he's always making these kinds of little cracks, right, where he's taking their words and throwing them back at them in a way that reveals a truth they didn't intend. If we go, for example, to the scene in which Hamlet meets Polonius, it's Act 2, Scene 2. Around line 168. And can I actually get a couple of volunteers? Can I get a Hamlet and a Polonius?
I'll do Polonius.
Okay. Can I get a Hamlet? Act 2, Scene 2, around line 168. Anybody want to be Hamlet? Anyone at all? Don't make me pick somebody.
What's the first
one? It would be, Give Me Leave, How Does My Good Lord Hamlet. Austin, you be Hamlet.
Oh, give me leave. How does my good lord Hamlet?
Well, God have mercy.
Do you know me, my lord?
Excellent. Well, you are a fishmonger.
Not I, my lord.
Then how would you were so honest a man?
Honest, my lord?
I say, be honest as this world goes, is to be one man picked out of 10,000.
Okay, hold up there for a second. When Hamlet calls Polonius a fishmonger, does anybody know what he's actually calling him? What is a fishmonger, literally?
He's someone who sells fish.
Yeah, a fishmonger is someone who sells fish.
He's calling him a liar?
He's not calling him a liar, no.
Filthy?
In Elizabethan slang, fishmonger was a word that meant pimp. So he's calling Polonius a pimp. Now, why would he be calling Polonius a pimp? What does Polonius think is wrong with Hamlet? Why does he think Hamlet is acting mad?
He's after his daughter?
Yeah, that's for love of Ophelia, right? And Ophelia has spurned him. So what Polonius continually does is throw Ophelia into Hamlet's path, right? To try to get some kind of read on him, to observe their behavior together. So, Hamlet insults Polonius here by calling him a pimp. It's like, because you're always waving your daughter in my face. All right, so if you guys could keep going there from, that's very true, my lord, Polonius.
It's very true, my lord.
For if the sun breed maggots and a dead dog, being a god-kissing carrion, have you a daughter?
I have, my lord.
Let her not walk a son. Conception is a blessing, but as your daughter may conceive, friend, look to it.
How could you say that? Still harping on my daughter, yet he knew me not at first.
He said, basically,
was a fishmonger. Ah, is far gone. And truly, in my youth, I suffered much extremity for love. Very near this. I'll speak to him again.
Okay, so pause there again for a minute. Does Polonius get the joke? He does not understand, yeah, what Hamlet is referring to. So, this tells us something about Polonius as well, right?
Not very clever.
No, he's not clever, right? He's a plotter, he's a schemer, he's always throwing words out at people, but ultimately, you know, when faced with the kinds of double meanings of language that Hamlet plays with, he's out of his league. He doesn't get it. So when Hamlet is waving the truth in Polonius's face, much as Polonius is waving Ophelia in Hamlet's face, right, Polonius doesn't get the message. He doesn't see it. He's not smart enough to get the joke. So, how many of you, when you read this play in high school, as I assume those of you who have read the play before, that's where you encountered it? How many of you were taught that Hamlet is mad? Okay, a lot of you were taught that Hamlet is authentically crazy. Okay, you were not.
I was taught in the theater department.
Okay. And I would say that, yeah, there are some problems with the Hamlet is authentically crazy theory. I don't think the play actually supports that for a couple of reasons. The first, right in scene one, what does the play begin with? What's the first thing that happens?
Hamlet's out on a walk, and he sees the ghost of his father.
Hamlet's not out there in scene one. Yeah, the guards and Horatio, right? They're out on a walk, and they see the ghost of Hamlet's father. So it's actually probably worth going through this, because it actually does set up a lot of important things that make sense when the play closes, right? So, can we get a couple more people involved here? Can I get two guards? Can I get a Bernardo and a Francisco? Act one, scene one. Yep. All right, Bernardo, Francisco, anybody?
I'll be Bernardo.
All right, she's Bernardo. You're Francisco.
Okay.
All right. Can I get a Marcellus? You'll be Marcellus. And a Horatio.
I can do Horatio.
All right, there we go. So we start with a guard station atop the castle. Enter Bernardo and Francisco, two sentinels.
Who's there?
Nay, answer me. Stand and unfold yourself.
Long live the king.
Bernardo?
Ah, he.
You come most carefully upon your hour.
Tis now struck 12. Get thee to bed, Francisco.
For this relief, much thanks. 'Tis bitter cold, and I am sick at heart.
Have you had quiet guard?
Not a mouse stirring.
Well, good night. If you do meet Horatio and Marcellus, the rivals of my watch, bid them make haste.
I think I hear them. Stand ho, who's there?
Friends to this ground.
And liegemen to the Dane.
Give you good night.
Oh, farewell, honest soldier, I have relieved you.
Bernardo hath my place. Give you good night.
Exit Francisco.
Hola, Bernardo.
What is Horatio there?
A piece of him.
Welcome, Horatio. Welcome to Marcellus.
What has this appeared again tonight?
I have seen nothing.
Yeah, now you're Marcellus. Yep, you're Marcellus.
Horatio says, "'Tis but our fantasy, and will not let belief take hold of him. Touching this dreaded sight, twice seen of us, therefore I have entreated him along with us to watch the minutes of this night, that if again this apparition come, he may improve our eyes and speak to it."
Tush, tush. 'Twill not appear.
Sit down a while, and let us once again assail your ears that are so fortified against our story, what we have tonight seen.
Well, sit we down, and let us hear Bernardo speak of this.
Last night of all, when yon same star that's westward from the pole had made his course to illumine that part of heaven, where now it burns, Marcellus and myself, the bell then beating one.
Enter ghost.
Peace, break thee off, look where it comes again.
In the same figure, like the king that did.
Thou art a scholar, speak to it, Horatio.
Looks I not like the king? Mark it, Horatio.
Most like it. It heralds me with fear and wonder.
Okay, you guys can stop there, because I think this sort of makes the point, right? What is established in this scene about the ghost?
Other people can see it.
Yeah, that it's real. The ghost is actually there. It's not a figment of Hamlet's imagination. Other people have seen it. And why is it particularly important that Horatio has seen it? What's established about Horatio's character in the beginning here?
He doesn't believe in it.
He's a scholar.
Yeah, he's a scholar and a skeptic, right? And if Horatio, who doesn't believe in shit like this, can see the ghost and acknowledge its existence, then it must be real. The ghost is not a fantasy. There are points in the play when only Hamlet can see it. For example, in the scene in his mother's bedchamber. But by and large, we are meant to imagine the ghost as real. Now, the way this would have worked on the Elizabethan stage, right, the way the stage looked, it didn't look like the kind of stage where you see, you know, where you have that kind of almost like a window cut out of a wall. We call that a proscenium stage. The Elizabethan stage was outdoors. So just to give you a sense of what the theaters in which this was performed would have looked like. They were kind of outdoor amphitheaters. Where people would gather, like, the stage was just a raised platform in the middle of, they were based actually on inn courtyards, which is where these plays were performed before there were permanent theaters. And in the back wall, you would have two doors and a hanging tapestry. And when characters are listening in to other people's conversations, they'd hide behind this tapestry. So, you know, when Polonius is doing his plotting, right? This is where he would be hanging out. When Hamlet stabs him at the end of that bedchamber scene, this is where he is. There's also a little trapdoor here, which leads to the area beneath the stage with the actors called Hell. Because from those trapdoors, ghosts and actors playing ghosts or devils would come up and wander around on the stage. You usually had at the top as well a balcony with a little tower for playing things like battlement scenes. You know, so the guards walking the walls in this first scene, they would do it up there. The cheapest seats were right at the front of the stage, and they weren't seats, it was just dirt. And you just came and, you know, usually, you know, brought your lunch with you, and you paid a penny, and you sit and you watch the play. The box seats up around were more expensive, and were sort of for upper-class patrons. But this is one of the reasons you'll often find a mix of high tragedy and, you know, high poetic language and sensationalism and low comedy in a Shakespearean play, is because they have to please both levels of the audience, right? They have to please the upper-class patrons, so they'll keep coming back and paying money to see more plays. But you also have to please these people on the ground, because they've got food in their hands, and if they don't like the play, they will share it with you.
And so comes the tradition of throwing rotten tomatoes.
That's actually exactly where that comes from. The so-called groundlings would throw their food at actors they didn't like. One other thing to note about this, because of the way this is set up, it's really hard to get scenery on and off the stage. So most plays are performed with a minimum of scenery. This is why you will often get, particularly in early scenes in a play, characters giving you physical descriptions of the environment. They will say, I am in the Forest of Arden, right? Or I am walking the battlements at the Castle of Elsinore, that sort of thing, right? They'll tell you where they are so that they don't have to show it. Right, so to move on with this, right? So we've established the ghost is real, Horatio says so, so it must be true. Now, it's also important that a little bit further on, these guys theorize about why this ghost is walking abroad. If we look on the next page, right around line 70, we get a little bit of exposition from Marcellus and Horatio, right? Marcellus the soldier, Horatio the scholar. Right, Marcellus says, good now, sit down and tell me, he that knows, why the same strict and most observant watch so nightly toils the subject of the land, and why such daily cast of brazen cannon and foreign march for implements of war, why such impressive shipwrights, whose sore task does not divide the Sunday from the week? What might be toward that this sweaty haste doth make the night joint labor with the day? Who is it that can inform me? So what has Marcellus noticed going on in Denmark that he thinks might be connected with the ghost? Yeah, why are we making all these cannons? Why are we building all these ships? Why are we going around to the peasant villages and impressing soldiers, right? What's going on here? Why does it look like we're preparing for war? And Horatio responds, right? That can I, at least the whisper goes so. Our last king, whose image even but now appeared to us, was, as you know, by Fortinbras of Norway, thereto pricked on by a most emulate pride, dared to the combat, in which our valiant Hamlet, right, this is Hamlet Sr., the old king. For so the sight of our known world esteemed him, did slay this Fortinbras, who by a sealed compact, well ratified by law and heraldry, did forfeit with his life all those his lands which he stood seized of to the conqueror, against the which a moiety competent was gauged by our king, which had returned to the inheritance of Fortinbras, had he been vanquisher, as by the same covenant and carriage of the article designed, his fell to Hamlet. Okay, so basically, they go to war, Fortinbras of Norway loses, and so Norway becomes a tributary kingdom of Denmark, right? Has to pay tribute to Denmark. So we have these two kings, Hamlet Sr. and Fortinbras Sr., both of whom have sons. That also bear their names. Now Sir Young Fortinbras, of unimproved metal hot and full, hath in the skirts of Norway here and there sharked up a list of lawless resolutes for food and diet to some enterprise that hath a stomach in it, which is no other, as it doth well appear unto our state, but to recover of us by strong hand and terms compulsatory those foresaid lands so by his father lost. And this, I take it, is the main motive of our preparations, the source of this our watch, and the chief head of this post-haste and roamage in the land. So what is young Fortinbras doing?
He's not paying tribute.
Well, is it just that he's not paying tribute? What does he seem to be doing up in the, you know, up in the wastes of Norway? What is he doing that would lead Denmark to start building weapons and recruiting soldiers?
He's preparing for war.
Yeah, he's doing the same thing up there, right? To take back the lands his father lost. So this might seem like a side issue, but this is actually really, really important to the structure of the play, right? What this means, right? We know that Hamlet Jr. is the main Avenger character in the play. But we have another character off stage who has a father to avenge, right? His father was killed by Hamlet Sr. So we have another sort of parallel father-son relationship. With another Avenger. Now, there's actually a third relationship to watch in this respect as well, right? Is Polonius just Ophelia's father? He has the son, Laertes, as well, right? Now, Laertes, by the time we finish the portion for today, is still off in France continuing his studies. But he'll be back.
And Hamlet kills his father.
Yeah, since Hamlet has killed his father, yes. So these three storylines all parallel each other in various ways and will unite at the end of the play. And I would argue that this Norway thing, which is often cut out of contemporary productions of the play in order to make it shorter, since we don't seem to have the attention span that we used to, is actually really, really, really important to the structure of the play. In large part, because of what has happened within the Kingdom of Denmark and within its court and royal family. So, I want to show you a brief clip. This is from a BBC television production done not too long. Oh, bloody hell. There's usually a little stick you can use to grab it. Oh, I guess not. This is from a BBC television production from 2009, starring David Tennant as Hamlet and Patrick Stewart as the ghost. Because apparently there is no production of Hamlet, no film production anyway of Hamlet in existence that does not include Patrick Stewart playing some role or other. So what I want you to pay attention to is when the ghost explains to Hamlet what happened, what really happened on the day he died, I want you to pay attention to how he describes the process.
power is almost gone. When I suffer some tormenting flames, must render up myself. Hear me not! Let thy serious hearing to what I shall unfold.
Speak. I am bound to hear.
Thou shalt revenge when thou dost hear.
What?
I am thy father's spirit, doomed for a certain turn to walk the night, and for the day, confined to fasting fires, till the foul crimes done in my days of nature are burned and purged away. But then I am forbid to tell the secrets of my prison house. I could a tale unfold whose lightest word would harrow up thy soul, freeze thy young blood, make thy two eyes like stars start from their spheres. But this eternal blazon must not be to ears of flesh and blood. List! List! Oh, list! If thou didst ever thy dear father love, revenge is foul and most unnatural murder. Murder! Murder! Most foul, as in the best it is, but this most foul, strange, and unnatural.
Haste me to merit, that I with wings as swift as meditation or the thoughts of love may sweep to my revenge.
I find thee apt. It is given out that sleeping in my orchard, a serpent stung me. But know, thou noble youth, the serpent that did sting thy father's life now wears his crown.
Oh, my prophetic soul, my uncle!
Aye, that incestuous, that adulterate beast, with witchcraft of his wit, with traitorous gifts, won to his shameful lust. The will I must see me, virtuous queen. Oh, Hamlet, what a forming off was there from me, whose love was of that dignity that it went hand in hand even with the vow I made to her in marriage. And to decline upon a wretch whose natural gifts were poor to those of mine. But lust, though to a radiant angel linked, will sit itself in a celestial bed and prey on garbage. But soft. Ah, methinks I scent the morning air. Brief, let me be. Sleeping within my orchard, my custom always in the afternoon, upon my secure hour, thy uncle stole with juice of cursed Lebanon in a vial, and in the porches of mine ears did pour the leprous distillment, whose effect holds such an enmity with blood of man that, swift as quicksilver, it courses through the natural gates and alleys of the body, and with a sudden vigor doth posset and curd the thin and wholesome blood. So did it mine, and a most instant tetter barked about, most lazar-like with vile and loathsome crust, all my smooth body. Thus was I, sleeping by a brother's hand of life, of crown and queen at once dispatched. Oh, horrible! Most horrible!
Oh, God!
If thou hast nature in thee, bear it not! Let not the royal bed of death art be a couch for luxury and damned incest. But howsoever thou pursuest this act, taint not thy mind, nor let thy soul contrive against thy mother aught. Leave her to heaven, and to those thorns that in her bosom lodged.
Okay, so just, I think we get what we need here. So, what does the ghost reveal to Hamlet about his death? Yeah, it was not a natural death, he was murdered. And what's important about how he was murdered? Okay, well, he's sleeping in his orchard, right?
Pour like poison into his ears.
And his, yeah, his brother comes in and pours poison into his ears, right?
So he can get his wife.
And his crown.
Yeah.
Now, there's a theory, it was a sort of very common Elizabethan political theory, right? The idea was that the king had two bodies. Right, so the king, on the one hand, was just ordinary human being. Right? Henry Tudor, Hamlet of Denmark, right? Ordinary physical person. But the king also embodied the nation. So he had a human body and a sort of national political body. This is why if you ever read any of the speeches written by Elizabeth I, right, she often refers to herself as prince or king rather than as queen. This is what she's referencing, right? That her human body is female, but that according to the two bodies of the king theory, right, as the embodiment of the nation, she also has the body of a king. So the body of the king is the body of the country. Now, what does poison do to the body? Pardon? Yeah, it kills it, right? But how does it accomplish that?
By, it always makes things stop working.
Mm-hmm. It interferes with your body's natural processes, right? It corrupts the systems in your body in order to make them stop working. Now, this is pretty much the process that the ghost describes to Hamlet, right? He had thin and wholesome blood that then curdled and posseted when the poison was poured into his ear. And a Lazar-like crust appears all over his smooth body. Lazar-like means sort of like leprous, right? Everybody knows what leprosy is, right? It's that kind of like flesh-devouring disease. Yeah, essentially, yeah, your flesh rots while you're alive.
Like so, necrosis.
Yeah, yeah. So his smooth an uncorrupted body becomes leprous as his brother pours the poison into his ear, right? And then there's sort of this, you know, all this language of taint and corruption. There's a point at which Marcellus even says that something is rotten in the state of Denmark, right? So what this reflects is not just the king's own death, but that the kingdom has gone completely wrong, right? It's not just the king who's been murdered and corrupted. The whole system in Denmark is rotten. At the beginning of this scene, for example, Hamlet is, you know, explaining to Horatio what all those noises are, right? Oh, that's my uncle partying, right? He does that all the damn time now. That is how he uses his power as king. What an asshole.
So not only does he murder his brother and usurps the political throne, corrupts the king, and then the political identity of the king.
Exactly. Yeah. He's broken up the family and inserted himself in the father's place.
And now he's breaking up
And he's breaking up the nation as well by wasting his time partying. And with little private intrigues, right?
Not doing his job?
Yeah. While young Fortinbras up in Norway is gathering his forces together, right? Building up his army, building up his influence, and just waiting for his chance to come down and avenge his father. So, when Claudius should be most vigilant, he's staying up all night drinking. Now, another thing to note at the end of this particular scene, when Hamlet comes back out to Horatio and Marcellus and swears them to secrecy, right, if we look at the end of Act 1, Scene 5, around line 165, Hamlet says to Horatio, "There are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy. But come, here as before, never, so help you mercy, how strange or odd some'er I bear myself, as I perchance hereafter shall think meet to put an antic disposition on, that you, at such times, seeing me, never shall, with arms encumbered thus, or this head shake, or by pronouncing of some doubtful phrase, as well we know, or we could, and if we would, or if we list to speak, or there be, and if they might, or such ambiguous giving out, to note that you know aught of me. This do swear, so grace and mercy at your most need help you." Right. The key phrase in this is antic disposition. I'm going to put on an antic disposition. Right. I am going to act like I'm crazy. I am going to act like I've lost my wits. You two know the truth. You two know what is really going on. No matter what I say, no matter what I do, don't tell anyone and don't let on that you know. Right, so further evidence for Hamlet's lack of madness, right? Now, there is, unfortunately, collateral damage as the play goes on from his behavior, right? He does not intend for Ophelia to die, but she does. He does not intend for Polonius to die. He kills him thinking he's killing the king. And these two other gentlemen just seem to wander blithely and blindly into this. Now, they're not actually all that important to this play, but they're going to be important in a play that we're going to read a little bit later on, so I don't want to completely ignore them. Right, who are Rosencrantz and Guildenstern?
I'll put the ambassadors.
Well, they're not ambassadors. Do these guys have any actual specific court function? They show up at the same time as the ambassadors. If you look at the beginning of Act 2, Scene 2. A public room, enter King, Queen, Rosencrantz, and Guildenstern. The king says, "Welcome, dear Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. Moreover, that we much did long to see you, the need we have to use you did provoke our hasty sending. Something you have heard of Hamlet's transformation, so call it, sith nor the exterior nor the inward man resembles that it was, what it should be, more than his father's death, that thus hath put him so much from the understanding of himself, I cannot deem of. I entreat you both, that being of so young days brought up with him, and sith so neighbor to his youth and havior, that you vouchsafe your rest here in our court some little time, so buy your companies to draw him on to pleasures, and to gather so as much as from occasion you may glean, whether aught to us unknown afflicts him thus, that open lies within our remedy. So these guys are his childhood friends, and they've been invited to the court. The king first says to draw him on to some entertainment and make him feel better, right? He's not like he used to be. He's always dressed in black. He's always making these long speeches about suicide. And he's been, you know, he's not been himself lately. So draw him on to some entertainment. Oh, and while you're at it,
spy on him,
yes. Come back to me when you find out what afflicts him. And you will be well rewarded. So the king is using Hamlet's childhood friends to spy on him. And these guys really make a hash of it, right? They're lousy spies. One thing we see about Rosencrantz and Guildenstern when they do meet up with Hamlet is that their attempts to draw him out are really, really clumsy. And he's so much smarter than they are that he just runs circles around them. All right, if we look at Act 2, Scene 2, around line 226, Hamlet has met up with his childhood friends. They're catching up, right? Your news is not true. Let me question more in particular. What have you, my good friends, deserved at the hands of fortune that she sends you to prison hither, right? I didn't send for you. You don't typically come to visit me of your own volition, right? Why do you come to see me now? Why do you come here to prison in Denmark? Prison, my lord? Denmark's a prison. Then is the world one. A goodly one in which there are many confines, wards, and dungeons, Denmark being one of the worst. We think not so, my lord. Why then 'tis none to you, for there is nothing either good or bad, but thinking makes it so. To me it is a prison. Why then your ambition makes it one? 'Tis too narrow for your mind. Oh God, I could be bounded in a nutshell and count myself a king of infinite space, were it not that I have bad dreams, which dreams indeed are ambition, for the very substance of the ambitious is merely the shadow of a dream. A dream itself is but a shadow, truly, and I hold ambition of so airy and light a quality that it is but a shadow's shadow. What word do Rosencrantz and Guildenstern keep harping on here?
Ambition.
Ambition, over and over again, yes. It's your ambition that troubles you. So, we've already discussed Polonius's theory of what ails Hamlet, right? That he's lovesick. What theory do Rosencrantz and Guildenstern seem to be putting forth?
I would dare say it's because the truth that he has an ambition for the throne or something?
Yeah, that it's because he's been blocked in his ambition to be king of Denmark that he's upset. That this is what has turned his mind.
Also, how old is Hamlet?
Hamlet is supposed to be a university student. Now that, in, you know, Renaissance Europe, could really be about any age, but yeah, probably fairly young. So yeah, I don't know. Have any of you ever seen the Mel Gibson Hamlet? Yeah, he was way too old to be Hamlet.
So about 14, 15, maybe 16?
No. Probably more like in his early 20s.
All right, then I can see how they draw that conclusion then.
Well, think of it less in terms of any psychological complexity on the part of Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, who are bunglers, and more in terms of who they work for. What does this tell us about their loyalties? Are they loyal to Hamlet? No. They are loyal to the king. and they are trying to tamp down any sort of rebellious tendency that they see in their childhood friend, right? No, no, no. No ambition for you, right? You are too smart to be ambitious, right? You're too clever. Ambition won't get you anywhere. But he just runs circles around these guys, draws out from them that, yes, they were sent for, and tells them at the end of this scene, right, I am mad but northwest. When the wind is southerly, I know a hawk from a handsaw. Right? So I am not as crazy as I look. Right? I know what's going on. I know what the lay of the land is. Right? If you mess with me, you're going to get hurt. And we'll see what happens to these two unfortunates in Acts 4 and 5. But yeah, all right, so that's about all the time we've got. Does anybody have any questions about anything? All right, so if you did not get me the articles you worked from last time, remember to email them to me. Otherwise, I will see you on Wednesday.